Today's topic is part one of puppy behavior and training. And today's topic essentially deals with the initial stages where bringing up your puppy correctly is going to prevent a lot of behavior problems later on. Our speaker today is Anthony John Lobo, fondly known as Tony Lobo, who is a very popular Indian National Kennel Club obedience judge. Mr. Lobo has trained over 3,000 dogs and is guiding humans and dogs to create a balance and bond for the past four decades. In the year 2007, Mr. Lobo featured on Heavy Petting for NDTV Good Times in a number of series where he would train all dog owners to train their dogs themselves. Mr. Lobo has also done an episode for UTBI News Cracking Careers, where he inspires and trains upcoming. The title Dog Whisperer was given to him through these channels. Mr. Lobo was trained in dog psychology by Paul Loeb of UK. Mr. Lobo is also a three-time MMA champion for the years 1997, 1998, and 1999, where he's also a professional trainer to humans, most of them being celebrities. Mr. Lobo believes that there's never a bad dog. It's always bad upbringing of a puppy, bad owners and bad trainers. Mr. Lobo strives to let all dog owners get the best out of their dog because each dog is different. With that, we would like to start our webinar. Over to Mr. Lobo.
Good evening, everybody. I hope I'm loud and clear. So, you know, INKC has a motto, a good life for dogs and dogs for a good life. Let's begin with the same thing, because when you get a dog, first thing, it has to be a family joint issue whenever you get a puppy into your home. Am I being heard?
Yes, you're audible.
Yeah. So whenever you get a puppy into our home, sometimes it's only the single person's want that brings the puppy home, or two people involved. The entire family doesn't get involved when the puppy comes home. You see, it's like adopting a child. And when you get a puppy home, first thing you must understand, the puppy's left his mother and come to you, and his first time seeing so many humans around him, him or her, the puppy. So some people, when you get it into the home, they are not used to the dog. Without their concern, you bring it and they don't like the dog or they don't like the puppy. They don't like what you bought. But out of your stubbornness, you go and bring a puppy at home. Remember, dogs, puppies follow the energy. You may love your puppy. You may love. Your energy might be very sound to your puppy. Your puppy may love you. But the puppy gets confused when it interacts with the other family members. Like, why am I being hated? Why am I being shooed away? Why am I saying, shoo, shoo, go away from your shoe. Take your dog and go there. So, you know, before getting the puppy, first thing is get a family concern. Get everybody involved. It's like bringing a child home. For 10 to 15 years, you're going to stick with that puppy over there. So don't make it unpleasant. Don't make it miserable for that puppy. Secondly, when you get a puppy home, even if it's consent of the family members, the most important thing you should understand, your puppy may understand any language. You may talk to it in Hindi, Marathi, Tamil, Telugu, English. You name the language. The puppy doesn't learn languages and come. What does it understand? It understands your facial expressions, your body gestures, and the tone of your voice. These three become a language to your puppy. So if you try and give big dialogues and big sentences to your puppy, remember, it's all gone over your puppy's head. Your puppy doesn't have that attention span to listen to big sentences of yours. So remember the three rules: tone of your voice, facial expressions, and body gestures. This is the language you have to communicate with your puppy. Next, remember that when we are as kids in school, we are taught our vowels, A, E, I, O, U as a human being. Sounds like we keep going on. But in a puppy world, we have only four vowels. A, E, O, And last but not the least is the S. So everybody who gets the puppy home should memorize these three vowels, four vowels. A, E, and O. Now, why is the three vowels important? A is a sound you can use for checking. First thing when you get a puppy home, if your puppy is nibbling on something or going on something, no, no, no. We keep on shouting the word, no, don't do this. No, not doing, don't do this. This no becomes a song to the puppies. No becomes a bad word to the puppies. Use the sound A that sounds correctly, that goes in the brain of your puppy. In puppy world, the second is E. E is always a squeaking sound that when an animal is in trouble, there's a squeak, which ends up sounds like E. And last of not the last, the second last is the O. O in a puppy world is always a surprising sound. Oh, what is that? Oh, so the puppy gets attentive on the sound of O. So whenever you name a dog, let's complete the last one is S. S is normally used as a relieving word. S is used as, okay, something good has been done. So trainers anywhere around the world, when they train the dog and they reward the dog, they use the word yes. So yes becomes loud and clear. The puppy, oh, I finished, I have accomplished something. So S is always an accomplishment. Now let's see when you name your puppy. Some people name their puppy with any and anything, which doesn't even rhyme to the puppy. With the puppy takes it very long to register the name. Till the dog, I notice, is 1 year or 8 months, the dog still doesn't know, the puppy doesn't know their name. So whenever you name your puppy, see that it sounds like anything like A, E, O, or S. This is the first sign to name a puppy. Now, when you get a puppy home, remember the three letter P's. If you find it difficult, what I'm saying, you can just note it down. I think it'll be better if you note it down because it'll help you. Second, the rule when you bring your puppy in and you want to communicate to your puppy, remember the three letter P's. First P is patience. Always be patient with your puppy. Don't be arrogant and demand standards at a very young age. If you were in KG class and your teacher demanded lots from you, I guess you would have never ever gone to school. Patience. Second P, praises. Whenever your puppy does something good, always stroke praises. Don't create a hyperness by showing so much excitement. Oh, what you have done, very good. You know, you create excitement to a very high level. Praise your puppy. Let it be a moderate praise and a good praise. Stroke your puppy. And last but not the least is persistence. If ever you tell your puppy, even on a small command of sit, don't keep singing the song. Sit, sit, come on, sit, sit, sit. 7, 8, 10 sits with one treat in your hand. It doesn't work that way. Your puppy will think, oh my God, this person is mad. What is he saying? So you have to just say one word, sit. Stare in the puppy's eyes and control your body motion. Because the more you move, your puppy, I told you, is subjected to looking at you and following your energy. So when you move and you keep saying, sit, sit with the treat in your hand, your puppy is distracted. It doesn't know what to understand. So whenever you sit, tell your puppy to sit. Make it very short. Stare in the eyes. Wait for some time, for at least for 10 to 15 seconds or maybe 20 seconds before you tell your puppy again to sit. Don't repeat the word. We need dogs that are trained in one command. I've been telling all the trainers, don't keep repeating commands. Your puppy heard you once. Your dog did hear you. Don't repeat over and over again. You just become, you know, a part of a person is telling the puppy something and the puppy ignores you and walks away. So that is the second part. Secondly, now when you bring a puppy home, your vet will tell you, your breeder will tell you, your dog needs to be fed at least 4 to 5 times a day because it's a newborn, it's a small puppy. Play the game of follow the leader. don't just put your puppy food on the floor. Don't put, let the puppy look at you and know something good is going to happen. Make the feeding time excited. Tell your puppy, come on, let's have a meal and play the follow the leader game. At a very young age, if the puppy looks at you and follows you for a food, which is but natural, will happen if you just motivate your puppy and knows that, okay, now it's feeding time. So take and put the feed down, feed your puppy, and to follow the leader game on every meal. Make it excitement. Okay, come on, we're going to have a meal. Do you want? Okay, come on. Let your puppy follow you. Then put the meal and place it down. Now, what happens is people who are too busy, who have servants and depends on servants to feed the puppy, and you tell them, okay, chalo, bichara baby bhooka hai, usko khila do khana. The servant will take the food, put it down like a dog, like people treat dogs, put it down and they are gone. The puppy, if it's hungry, will smell and eat and go away. It'll leave half food and go away. That food which you have left over there, or the servant is left there, will lie for 3 hours, 4 hours. Rene do puppy, agar you feel like, okay, he'll be hungry, he'll come and eat. No. If your puppy doesn't eat the meal in 10 minutes, if your puppy doesn't eat, the food has to be removed. Don't keep any food lying on the floor or waiting for your puppy to come and eat after some time. No, you are treating your puppy very bad habits of being choosy about food. Your puppy will smell it and walk away and say, hey, this dog food doesn't agree. My puppy is not eating this dog food. Or my dog is not eating this food. Let's try something else. Then you'll bring another food and you'll keep it down. Again, you'll do the same mistake by keeping the food there and walking away. The puppy will smell naturally, it's something new. We'll eat it or may eat it full. But it'll again want that food will be lying there. So don't keep food there. You make your dog lazy. You make your dog less motivated towards humans, towards you, if food is kept open. Keep your food every time during the meal. Whenever the puppy's meal time is there, put the food, let him know, okay, it's my meal time. Something good is going to happen. And then keep the food. Next, whenever a puppy eats his food, always make it a point to take him out to relieve himself for peeing or pooping. Remember, what goes in naturally tries to come out within a few minutes. So to relieve the puppy, many people have this problem. Oh, my puppy is just peeing 20 times a day in the house. But natural, it will happen because you didn't found rules and boundaries. Remember, when you get a puppy home from the very first day, you have to create rules, boundaries, and limitations. Now, what is rule, boundaries, and limitations? The first rule is feed your puppy on fixed time. When you feed on fixed time, the puppy will pee and poop on fixed time. And this habit lasts throughout old age. Your puppy becomes a design to discipline. So take your puppy, feed him, take him out to relieve himself, or take him to your bathing room or wherever you want to take your puppy. What happens? You feed your puppy and leave him loose. The entire house is the jungle. The entire house is the peeing, the toilet, the bathroom area. It'll go smelling, smelling, smelling. Then say, oh my God, my puppy is going to pee over here. And there the puppy pees over there. Then you go and scold the puppy. So this doesn't make any sense. You gave him the liberty to go and pee and poop. And then you scold the puppy. The puppy gets confused. Okay, why am I being scolded? Are this place is mine. People have the problem of taking the puppy on a leash and going out for a stroll. They stay 1 hour, 2 hours with the puppy. And when they bring it back, the puppy doesn't pee outside. It comes up and pees in the house and poops in the house. And this, I get a call for 8 to 9 times at least in a month. That why my puppy is only peeing and pooping in the house and not going outside. Remember, again, I'm telling you, when your puppy peed the first time in the house, in the middle of the peeing act, you went and scolded the puppy. You scold the puppy, hey, what are you doing? Stop it, stop it, stop it. You must understand the puppy has already started peeing. Your house is already soiled. By you shouting in the middle of the act, you created a fear phobia that of you being there, I must not pee. So when you take the leash and take your puppy out, your puppy is looking at you. Oh my God, if I pee, he shouted at me in the house. He's going to shout at me here. So the puppy controls himself. And then when you bring the puppy back home and release your puppy, then the corner it goes and pees itself. Now you tell me, if the puppy is going to associate you as the person negative of peeing in front of him, how are you going to teach your puppy where to pee and poop? So if your puppy pees, wait, let him complete the pee. When he pees, take him and keep him in an isolated area. This is the way you punish puppies. I don't agree with the word punishment, but you can scold your puppy verbally, not by screaming on tip of your voice, but by changing your tone of voice in a rougher tone. Who did this? What is this? Make it short and with a lot of bass in your voice. Your puppy gets the message that, okay, this is not right. This is not my owner's voice. And he's angry about something. Because dogs understand growls. Small growl, big growl, barks, tiny barks, big barks. On a bark, we come to know whether the dog is an aggressive bark, a nervous bark. So change your voice when you want to scold your puppy. You don't have to beat your puppy. Some people, I have got a lot of people saying, take the puppy's nose and put it in the pee and in the urine. This is all rubbish. Don't do this. When you wipe your place where the puppy pees, you can just swab your place with white vinegar. Not brown vinegar, white vinegar. Why? White vinegar, because in white vinegar, we have the pure acid smell that drowns the puppy's urine acid dominant smell. With brown vinegar, because there is sugar burnt substance inside, so it doesn't work. So use white vinegar next time whenever your puppy pees to clean up the plates. Another thing is, I have heard many, many people say, my puppy is biting my hand, or the puppy has, you know, is nipping one more thing. And you know, there are big dog hand, just scream and your puppy will leave your hand. This is not right. Let me tell you again, when your puppy's hand and you scream, your puppy will leave your hand at that time, but you leave your puppy with a sense of dominance. Your puppy just realized, okay, I just achieved something by biting this guy. He did feel pain. So that means I'm quite superior to this guy. The puppy gets an imprint. So how do you check that? Is first thing, as your puppy bites your hand, don't pull back your hand. Our human reflexes, if we pull our hand back, don't pull, because when you pull your hand back and try to hide your hand, you show sense of fear. Your puppy understands that you are afraid of the teeth of his. First thing, get the same impression is, your puppy is new. He doesn't have hands to call you. When there are puppies in the pen, they play by holding onto one another's neck, by holding onto one another's ears. This is acquaintance in the puppy gathering. That same puppy comes home. He wants to practice that acquaintance. So he holds your hand. He pulls your hair. He catches your clothes. He pulls at it. Now these, if not checked at the right time or not corrected, can lead to severe problems later on. Some people let go and say, oh my God, it's okay, okay, but I can bear it. No. How do you check these problems? By screaming and say, no. I told you, people, somebody just messaged me and said, I scream and my puppy leaves.
Hello, man. Have a good evening.
I said, if you scream and your puppy leaves,
can everyone please mute their mics because the extraneous noise is a little distracting. Everyone please mute the mics while the talk is on. And if you have any questions, you can just type it in the chat box. we'll get to it at the end of the talk.
Yeah, thanks, Rhea. So what I was saying is, so if ever you scream the word ee and the puppy leaves, remember you left a dominant puppy loose. You left a puppy that got the sense of supremacy that says, okay, if I catch somebody's hand and I can get through, they can still be under me. Don't let that happen. So how do you correct this behavior? First thing, never pull your hand back, as I've just said. Hold, change your voice. Now, this is the time where I use the word A. So one short word, more powerfully. Or I use the word A, O, and I gently rub the puppy's nose upwards. Nobody likes being touched by the nose. When you brush the puppy's nose gently upwards, they sneeze. You're telling your puppy, if you do something to me that I don't like, I'll do something to you that you won't like. Remember the rule, never pull your hand back, because when you pull your hand back, you teach your puppy that you are afraid of that bite. As I told you, the puppy doesn't mean to bite you. It is just acquaintance. He just wants to hold on to you and see what is your reaction, because that he learned in the playpen with the other siblings of his puppies. By catching another puppy's ears and catching the other puppy's neck and pulling and shaking their head, that's what they learn at a very small age. So when he comes to you, he's going to do the same behaviors. Feeding time is the most important thing. Follow the leader game is the most important thing. After meal, taking the puppy out to relieve himself or places where you want him to or her to relieve himself is the most important thing. Family-oriented support, that is the ultimate requirement for a puppy. Because if there is some members in the family that don't like your puppy or not comfortable with the puppy around, your puppy will grow up with mixed feelings. And when a puppy grows up with mixed feelings, it is not a healthy mentally puppy. It will be a very nasty puppy. It will be a very unpredictable puppy. Last but not the least, whenever bringing a puppy home, please don't follow what your friends have bought or what some celebrity dog has bought. Because celebrities also make the same mistake. They bring the puppy of their life that they want, not knowing the breed, the standard, the requirement of the puppy. And that is what they get at home. And then they're surprised how the puppy is growing into another direction. People with flats and all not taking the puppy mods go and bring bulldogs. They get Siberian huskies. They get Mudul hounds. I know of people who, and there is no exercise or enough for these type dogs, which leads to very hyper extension in the house. The hyperness creates because these puppies need to burn that energy. I'll give you one small example. When you take your puppy for a bath and you bring him out, you leave your puppy loose for the first 10 minutes, that puppy will run up and down, till it'll bang into places if your puppy is a very high energetic dog. But all puppies, whether high or low, will run after a bath. Now you must understand, when you give your dog bath, a puppy's temperature is 101. Normal temperature of any dog or puppy is 101. A human's is 98. Remember, this time when you're bringing the puppy, it runs because it wants to raise the body temperature. It wants to come back to that body temperature, so the run is there. So the expel of energy is there. So whenever the puppy is running, make sure that your puppy exerts his energy in a right way, not banging into stuff or creating destruction or taking something and running. No, it is your responsibility. Again, I said, boundaries, rules, and limitations that come inside, that later on you will learn and how to train your puppy and how it has to be done systematically. Because without limitation, rules, and boundaries, you will have one of the most undisciplined dogs. One more point. A puppy is a dog. A dog, remember again what I'm saying. A puppy is a dog. A dog is an animal. And an animal will always be an animal. people say, oh my God, he's my child, he's like my child. And they treat the puppy like a child, which is the baddest thing any human can do. And it's not fair on the puppy. It is definitely not fair on the puppy. You can love the dog, your puppy, like a child. Again, I repeat the word, love your puppy like a child. But don't treat your puppy like a child, like a human child. Definitely not. You're being unjust to that breed, to that puppy, to the growing up of that dog. Again, I said a dog is an animal, and an animal will always be an animal. And a puppy has a dog instinct, which will need to grow up in those type of instincts. Don't put your human instincts and force the puppy to be like a human, because it resembles, okay, it's this one's avatar and that one's avatar. And we need to, you know, he's like a child. He's got somebody's soul into it. No. Don't confuse that poor soul in your house that comes. Be very practical. Give your puppy the best. Love him like a child. Don't treat him like a child. You want a good dog to grow up well, healthy. Like I told you, Ian Casey's rule is that a dog for a good life for dogs. Now, what does that mean? I even explained to you. When you get a dog into your home and into your life, you will see your life will change. You will have so much of positive, it's my personal experience, I don't know what you may feel, but you get so much of positive energy, positive thoughts. You learn about feelings. You'll know about care. And when you give the same thing back to the puppy, you learn to care. A good life for dogs. We are giving a good life. This is the most beautiful theme and motto this of our INKC club. And we wish that everybody understands this, what this motto means. So when you give a good life to your puppy, you should be well satisfied. Wow, I've done my best for my dog. That should be the pride you hold. So again, I say, make your puppy grow up in a very right and according to the breed standard and requirement of that puppy. Now, people get confused by getting a Labrador and a Husky is the same bringing up. You get a Husky and a German Shepherd is the same bringing up. No. Your Husky will destroy more work in your house than any other breed that will do. People may get some other different breeds that will be stubbornness. Just I'll give you an example of a Dalmatian. They are utility dogs. A bulldog. They're utility dogs. Now, what are utility dogs? What are they meant for? Their lifespan of concentration is very short. You can't put that thing. So if ever you're going to train these type of dogs, you have to train them in short and very perfect durations, very firm durations with good reward. What do you train for your dog with? A good reward or a toy? Reward when you use food, see that the food is not used every time. This will become a pattern. Learn to switch. We'll come to the training part later. So what I'm saying is follow rules, discipline, limitations, and boundaries. This is very important in the initial stages of your puppy. So let's take, if anybody has any questions, let's send some questions for somebody who has any problem or anything to be said.
We'll take the questions at the end.
Okay.
Whoever has any questions can put the questions in the chat box. You can type it into the chat box and we'll read out the questions to you at the end.
Okay, I think it's about the crate, putting puppies in crate, right?
Yeah, socialization and crate training.
Very good topic. Okay, for everybody, am I loud and clear? Let me confirm this once again because this is a very important topic.
Am I loud and clear?
Yes. Okay, so socialization of a puppy, remember one thing, if anybody takes a puppy out, remember one thing, socialization doesn't mean your puppy has to go and meet other dogs. Or other dogs have to come and meet your puppy. No, a big no. That is not called socialization. Socialization means your puppy is comfortable with people around him, with other dogs around him, and you have control over your puppy. socialization means your dog, your puppy is comfortable even when you stand on the road with traffic sound. Your puppy is adapted to any sound, sudden sounds, explosion sounds, or freaking noises. That is called socialization. Socialization again means, doesn't mean an adult dog comes and smells your puppy and your puppy with fear goes and sits and tells you, and you go and tell him, no, don't worry. He's not doing anything. He's a nice dog. See, he's so calm. No, that is not socialization. Don't introduce your puppy in that manner. If your puppy wants to smell another puppy, you have to confirm with the other dog owner, is your dog okay if my puppy smells him? Socialization means where you being around many people, many dogs in the park, in areas, and your puppy is in the calmest state of mind. He's not nervous with his tail down and you dragging him towards it. That is not socialization. Socialization means where you hold on to your ground and your puppy is looking at the traffic or looking at other dogs or looking at other people and trying to recollect and understand what is the situation. Only by you being and standing near your puppy will get the confidence, okay, I am safe. I can handle the traffic sound. I can handle other dogs. I am safe. What happens when you pull the puppy towards the traffic? You pull the puppy towards the, you know, sound of the traffic, or pull the puppy where other dogs are playing and your puppy doesn't want to go. You are just accelerating the problem. Your puppy is saying, I'm already frightened of the environment and this owner is dragging me. I'm frightened of my owner also. Your puppy starts building less faith into you. Simple thing you have to do is hold on to your puppy. If there's a place to sit, sit with your puppy. Let your puppy absorb. Observe things around. You know, your puppy is learning sounds, vision, smell, other dogs peeing on the road. Let your puppy understand that. Don't force. You know, when you take your puppy for a stroll, there is another part of socialization is your puppy will not will to go in certain areas, certain places, certain turns, because there is some dominant dog that has peed over there and left a scent mark. Or your puppy is not comfortable in that type of a road because of a sound. You have to hold on to your ground. Don't give your puppy big lectures and say, no, nothing is there. Don't worry. I'm there with you. Instead of that, just stand and hold your puppy without any words. I told you, don't use words. Words are rubbish to a puppy. Your eyes, your gestures, your touch says a lot more than what other words you're going to tell your puppy. So these are the things I want you to know about socialization. So again, I'm saying socialization, no taking your puppy and putting it in front of the problem and saying, don't worry, nothing will happen. I'm there with you. Putting it another front of dog or approaching another dog and saying, don't worry, this dog is okay. Sometimes you will know when you ask the other person, is your dog okay? The person, yeah. My dog is very cool. He never bites and all. And trusting that person, you take your puppy to that dog. You know what that other dog, he will smell. They smell each other's butt. When they smell butts and the private parts, it's like saying, who are you? A lot of information is being traveled by smelling the butts and the private portion. Your name, everything goes through that. It's like a postcard each of them send. And if the other puppy finds himself a little dominant, the other dog, and puts a paw on your puppy's back, remember, that's again authority. That's trying to say, okay, or tries to mount on the shoulder of your puppy. That is again proving dominance, telling your puppy, see, I'm superior to you. You should not let that happen. Intervene at that time. Don't let the puppy be at your mercy of the other person's dog. Bring your puppy back, hold on to your ground, stay there, don't walk away from the situation. People walk away when they find this thing. You're teaching your puppy fear when you walk away from other situations. Don't teach your puppy fear. Your puppy has to love the environment, love people around him, and you need a happy puppy. whenever you train also, your puppy should be waiting for. I have had a bunch of trainers that come and go to people's houses. When they come, the puppy goes running and runs under the bed. They don't want to come out because the training session becomes, you know, undisciplined. The training session is not fun. The training session becomes very much too much of pressure. So puppies want to run away. And then what the trainer or anybody comes to train will say, please, please, you all go away. You're sitting there. So the puppy doesn't want to be trained. The puppy seeing you and running away. So you please go away. That is bullshit. That is rubbish. Don't listen to those type trainers who tell you, please go away. Leave your puppy with me. No. You have to sit and watch your puppy being trained. Don't leave your puppy at the mercy of a trainer. That is also part of socialization. When you sit there, you tell your puppy, okay, good things are happening. You will come to know whether your puppy is in good hands or good things are happening to your puppy or bad things are happening to your puppy. Out of fear that the trainer will not jerk your puppy tight on a choke chain or leash or won't kick your puppy on the backside or anything. So you sit, trainer is forced to use good attitude to train your puppy. So remember one thing, sit and watch your puppy being trained. It doesn't take long. So next time you get a puppy, see according to the breed standard, what is your requirement, and then get a puppy, what is meant for your home and yourself. Don't follow the mass and media that if this celebrity has got this breed, I need this breed. It's so adorable. Wow, it looks so beautiful. Such a powerful dog. I need this. People do mistakes and get like this to me. The most common breed which is coming in is like Rottweilers. Oh, such a powerful breed. I'm going to get a Rottweiler. Not knowing the standard of the Rottweiler. When you get a Rottweiler, your full personality will change. Trust me. It's the difference over there when you get a breed. So see the breed, what you need, what is required. How much time do you have for your dog? Is it required? And last of all, don't give puppies a gift. Please, please don't give puppies as gift unless you know. At the other hand, everybody, the entire family is waiting. Okay, we are fine with it. But if people give their fiancés and friends a gift, that one is happy, but the family is not happy. Don't do this mistake. It's not fair to the dog, to the breed, it's definitely not fair. Can we take a question next? Or can we take something else?
Do you want to take some of the questions now?
Yeah, I don't mind.
Okay.
Do you have another slide? Complete another slide. No? Then we'll
Can you see the slide?
Yeah. Very good. So it is toilet training and about tablets and syrups, how to give your puppy. See, the vet will always do his best and tell you what to do, what not to do. But the follow-up, you always have to do. You have to create a follow-up. People make the mistake by feeding the tablet of a puppy through the center of the mouth and pushing it in the throat. Don't do this. A big no, don't do this. Syrups are taken with a syringe or teaspoons and pushed through the center of the mouth. Don't do this. At one point of the mouth of a puppy, the trachea and the windpipe meet, and it's very narrow that it'll go through the puppy and it'll cough it out. The tablet is either spitted out or your dog or your puppy gets choked. Remember one thing, whenever feeding a tablet or a syrup, there is a pocket at the side of your puppy. When you lift the lip at the side, put it at the side and gently push it with your finger down. At ease, the tablet goes right in without your puppy even knowing that it has swallowed a tablet. From the side of your puppy's mouth, there's a flap. Push it through the lip right down and it goes. Same as the syrup. You can take a syringe, your vet will give you an empty syringe. Fill the syrup, don't put it in force, open the pocket and just drop the syrup into the pocket. Remember, when you put a syrup into the pocket, no matter how much your puppy tries by spitting it out, it doesn't come out. That syrup will never come out. It will be swallowed directly inside because it just sticks to the wall at the palate of your puppy's gums and it goes inside harmlessly. Again, I'm repeating, use the side pocket of your puppies to feed a tablet and a syrup, not the center of the mouth. Some people open the mouth, catch the teeth, press the mouth and open it vigorously and press the syringe in. Your puppy's eyes turn red. Did you ever notice that? Your puppy's eyes turn red. It literally tears up because of that force of that syringe. And sometimes your puppy coughs it off and half the syrup is out. Don't do that. So that's the way you feed syrup and tablets. That's the most safest and gentlest way. Now, what happens when people use force and open the mouth? We get these puppies that come to the vet with aggression when the vet is trying to just check them out. Because this behavior associates with unpleasantness, pain, discomfort. Your puppy will react to the vet. And then you say, haan, wo aisa hi karta hai. Mera muh pakdega, wo kaatne aata hai. The poor vet goes through these type of things because of your force and unknowingness of, you know, trying to feed your puppy on force. Use gentle methods and gentle ways and your puppy will love taking medicines and syrup. So don't get a puppy that's already troublesome and then tell your vet, aap hi khila do, humse nahi hota. This is very common I face this, very common. Aap hi khila do, madam, sir, aap khila do, doctor. हमसे नहीं होता है, हम लोग आते हैं ना, हम लोग को काटने आते हैं, सब फेंक देता है. क्यों? शुरुआत किसने किया? Who done this? Don't use this mouth opening and pushing the tablet. No. Please, this will help all the vets around if you learn to feed proper tablets and syrups. We want a happy puppy. And the next, I think, is the crate. Is the crate?
Yeah, yes. We had to talk about crate training also.
Yeah. So next is the crate. Now, when you get a crate or, you know, you want your puppy to go in the crate and travel somewhere and all, tell me one thing. Why will the puppy go in jail? Why should a puppy go in the crate? It is not right for the puppy to go in. It is feeling unsafe. Did you make the crate comfortable? When you take a puppy and push it in and close the door, what do you create? You create a phobia room. Like imprisonment, and the puppy is afraid to go inside. So whenever you train for crate or whenever you anything, make the crate fun. Make the crate, it'll take you maybe about 3 days if the puppy is good, or maybe 5 days, a maximum a week. But I think it shouldn't take more than 2 to 3 days if you do it the right way. Any treat you want to feed, feed it inside the crate. Let it go inside, eat the treat and come out. Don't close the door. Any toy you want to introduce your puppy wants, put it in the crate, let it pick it up and come out, fine. You want to feed the meal, keep it at the inside of the crate on the door, let it even put his head half inside and eat the meal, fine. Slowly put the meal a little more further inside the crate. Let it go inside, eat the meal, come out. Toys, keep your toy inside. Chew bones, chew sticks, as which I am against, but people don't listen, but they still have chew things. Put it inside. The puppy feels good. Let him go inside and come out. This has to be done for 2-3 days. No closing the door. Don't put a puppy in within the first 2 days and close the door. You're teaching the puppy that your freedom will be gone. You're going to be isolated. You're teaching the puppy punishment. So don't close the crate of the door for at least till you know your puppy is on a, you know, on his bed in the crate and is lying down and is comfortable chewing on a toy or biting his toy or, you know, happy over there. Till then, don't do that. Secondly, on the command, when you put something in, use one word. Crate or use go in or inside. You can use one word. Don't use big sentences. Come on, now go inside. Come on, you have to go inside. Come on now. Don't use all that. Just use the word crate or inside, one word, and make something. something good happen inside the crate. When the puppy goes in, don't close, come out. Let it be fun. Once you know that your puppy is in and is taking a nap in the crate, it felt good chewing, chewing, and is taking a nap in the crate, that is the time you are ready to even close the door. Don't close the door on a hyper-extended puppy over there and it's waiting to come out and you soon go and close the door. Again, you're teaching fear. You're teaching, you know, isolation. You're teaching it to be, you know, rebellious when it comes out and not will to go back in the crate. So let your crate training be slowly and effectively with good things happening inside the crate. Good things, again, I said, good things can be anything that the puppy loves inside the crate, but nothing good is happening outside the crate. Let's go to the next topic.
We also have to cover getting the pups used to being groomed.
Very good. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, okay. Now, most common people get Shih Tzus. I have a lot of complaints of Shih Tzus, Lhasas, miniature Poms. Okay, these are the ones that get very rebellious. Now, I'll tell you why. First time when your puppy grows and the hair starts growing, you all want to try it at home by grooming his hair and trying to open the knots. Now, one thing when you put a comb and try to comb your puppy's hair, those hair knots, even two hair that be pulled, creates pain on the skin. And your puppy reacts to that pain because you want to remove the knots. Naturally, you want to remove the knots. Why? Because your first mistake was you created that knots for keeping it for so long. You literally ignored those knots when they were forming. And when they're forming, one fine day, you took your comb and said, okay, let's try and pull. And now when you pulled it, the puppy felt pain and he wanted to fight back. He didn't want you to touch that coat. That puppy turns rebellious. It turns to bite that comb, bite your hand, anything that touches the skin or the coat. Again, who's at fault? First fault of yours? You let it linger for the knots to be there. Secondly, you try to use force, which is painful to the puppy. So this is definitely not the right way. If ever now you've already created knots and you want to comb the groom the puppy, what do you do? Shortcut, because you have the money, maybe you'll take it to the salon. Okay, let the dog go to the salon. Salon people will do. Most salon people have to either tie the puppy's mouth, keep their nose string, and keep it at the angle you have checked. And first thing the salon people will tell you, please stand out. Your dog will, this is what practically I'm telling you happens in salons. Please stand out because they don't want to see you, you'll feel bad as how the puppy is going to be groomed, which you had to do. Now they have to use it on force. What do? They keep the puppy on a stand. So they hold on to it and they wait for the puppy not to react. Then gently they try. If the puppy reacts, they stop the comb there only. They don't use force. So the puppy wonders, okay, if the comb is on me, it's okay. I can take it. Then gently they separate the knots and gently stroke. This is what you should have done when your puppy had knots from before. Now what happened is you made a reactive dog and took it to the grooming center to get groomed so that you are off your problems. Till the grooming next time and again there is knots, again you take. But when I want you to groom your puppy, you to take the initiative. If your puppy is hurtful, keep your hand there. Don't use force and try to make your way through the knots. You'll only get your puppy aggressive and coming to bite you. You can't do that. And you tie the puppy's mouth and say, no, abhi karlo, abhi pakda mai. This is torture. This is bad. And sometimes I know at grooming centers also this happens, but they can't help it because you have already created a very reactive dog. So a good groomer will hold on and wait and stroke the puppy and gently remove one knot at a time, but gently. That type of grooming will take longer than what you would groom anywhere. So for grooming, again, I says, pay attention to your dog's coat. pay attention when there is hair, and when you're trying to groom your puppy, use these iron combs. They are much better than your normal house combs. See that it's there. Don't force your way through. Get your puppy be comfortable with the smell of the comb by touching it, licking it, and then gently stroke through the hair. Let it be fun. Let your puppy find that there's energy flowing. Like when you comb your head with a brush and you find, you know, energy flowing through my hair, I feel good. The puppy is the same way, but if in childhood, if you were small and if you're a girl and your mother pulled your hair out, you would react the same way. So I want you to understand why does the puppy react. So grooming starts at home and then to the salon. Can we go in for the next one, please? Yeah, Fia?
Yeah, the basics of training.
Yeah.
I think a lot of it has been covered, but anything else you would like to...
Yeah, the basics of training is very important. First thing I said is follow the leader. Second, when you say follow the leader, suppose you want to train your puppy. Just say he's 3 months old and it's right and he said, okay, I get a trainer. First thing is, why should a dog want to listen? Why does a dog need to be trained? For you to show off to people that my dog does a sit, stand, down, come. No. Your puppy is not going to listen if his stomach is full. You need the puppy to be hungry if you're going to motivate the puppy. You can never train a puppy on a full stomach. If you're fed your puppy and a trainer comes in, definitely your trainer is going to use force to your puppy to make him do something because the puppy is not motivated. The puppy is not ready for training with a stomach full. So don't train your puppy on a full stomach immediately after eating. Or never exercise your puppy on a full stomach or make him run. That creates bloat. I have so many cases of bloat I have gone through and seen because of people uneducated, known, and after the puppy is eating, they make the dog run. They make the dog do some type of exercise and make them jump and it creates bloat. I think a vet can explain more better what bloat and how does it come. And the basic is always because activating a dog's core after a meal. A big no-no to anybody who's training a puppy after a meal. Let your puppy be hungry. If you want, use that same food. If your puppy loves the food so much, use that same food as a training base, as a training reward. Use the same food. Don't overfeed your puppy. Training bases, always follow the leader. I say, when your puppy says, okay, you tell it sit. No, I always believe in all my trainings, always one command. I don't believe in 3, 4, 5, 6 commands. No. Don't use. Use one command and stare into your puppy's eyes. Let your puppy know you mean it. Another point, don't move your shoulder, your body. Come on, sit. And you keep moving your head. Your puppy is focusing you. Why would you want to move? Be still. Stare. That is your persistence. That's the last P which I said. Patience, presence, and persistence. That's your persistence. Sit. Stare. Sat down. Reward. Yes. Always learn to teach your puppy a cue. The cue of freedom, the cue of getting into the word zone, a release command, you know, the cues used, yes, okay, now free, there's no commands more. Bringing in, come on, your puppy knows there's something going on. So get your puppy associated with one word. Don't make big sentences, don't confuse your puppy. Short, again, while I'll repeat the last sentence again is, don't use too many big sentences to your puppy. Make it short. Make your training sessions very short. Now, let me tell you, when you order a trainer home, but the trainer's grilled in his mind that he has to spend 1 hour with your puppy to prove to you that your puppy is listening, that he's training your puppy. No matter what happens, your trainer is overstressing your dog, is overtiring your dog mentally. He's not making training fun. Your trainer is not making training fun. because he has a time limit and he has to spend so much time with your puppy, so that you feel comfortable that my dog is being trained or my puppy is trained. Remember one thing, the puppy won't trust you also and the trainer. Your puppy will just refuse and training becomes more difficult. Make your training sessions short. Make the training sessions vibrant. Let there be, you know, fun. Let there be happiness. Let your puppy enjoy like every step that he done. Wow, there's a reward. There is something good to happen. If ever there is choke chains being choked, jerked hard on a 3-month-old puppy, as for me, I would tell you, I never use a leash, even a leash, on a puppy of 3 months or 4 months old. I would never lose it. I will use a leash only if I'm taking a puppy out for a walk. We will come to the leash methods later on. But when you train your puppy indoors, always it starts with indoors. You can't take your puppy out outdoors. Don't use a leash. A good trainer will not use a leash. He will motivate a puppy such a way that the puppy will follow him for something good going to happen and not run to the owner. If it runs to the owner, means the trainer is proving that he's not exciting as the owner. A trainer should have that aura and excitement that the puppy comes to him instead of going to the owner. So what trainers do when they don't have that, they'll say, tell the owner, please go away. He's not listening to me. Please stand one side and watch. This is not training. This is not training. Get something. I said, get a hungry puppy. Get something. You know, rewards, when you give a puppy, there are levels in rewards. Rewards which are of very high value worked better than a reward which a puppy gets always. The owner gives a puppy always. That reward doesn't work so much as if a trainer gets a reward of a value of a higher things. For example, I'll just give you a small example. If your owner of the dog puppy is giving the puppy nice, some flavored biscuits as a reward, and the puppy is excited. And when the trainer comes, he uses the same biscuit, the puppy will go back to the owner. Because that reward is more, my owner is giving, why I'll take from you? But if the trainer has a reward, like an egg white broken into small pieces, or a piece of cheese. I don't know, cheese doesn't work so much here. Or a piece of sausage. I don't know if sausage also much works. Or anything that is having a different, higher value, the puppy will come running to the trainer. We need a high value for a trainer who's training a puppy. The higher value, the higher motivation, the higher concentration, the higher focus of a puppy when he wants to be trained. So I think we completed this training session. Let's go to the next one.
Yes, thank you. We'll take all the questions soon.
Fine.
Before that, I'd like to just mention that a lot of the topics that have been covered today, I hope that the participants will follow it. Because the problems that you'll be preventing in your puppies as they grow are something, I mean, you really can't imagine just how difficult it can be to live with a dog who is not emotionally balanced and who hasn't been brought up well. So please do take the points that have been covered seriously. We will be getting to your questions soon. A lot of information about many of the topics that have been covered here have also been covered in the current issue of our annual magazine. So if anyone's interested in going through any of that in detail, you can order the magazine online at www.inkc.in. Before we get to the questions, I'd like to thank the advertisers in our magazine. Can we have the next slide, Chetan? Himalaya Healthy Pet Food for puppies and adults. Fresh Coat Dry Shampoo. Purina Super Coat Dog Foods. Vivaldis Calming and Anxiety Support Supplements. Portraits, Pet Portraits by Bhavesh Karia. FitPet kennels, EasyPet dewormer, MilkoPet from Zydus, NexGard tick prevention medication, Simparica tick prevention medication. Thank you. So we